Okay, well, my name is Clive Orchard, and I'm president of the Physiological Society. Although in my day job, I'm dean of the Faculty of Medical and Veterinary Sciences at the University of Bristol. When I get time off from that, I'm also a professor of physiology, and my research expertise is in cardiac physiology. However, this evening I'm here to introduce the Physiological Society's public lecture. This was a lecture that was introduced for the first time in 2005 by the Society because we wanted to publicise physiology and propagate it outside our own community. And so each year we approach the host university and try and identify one of their research stars to present this lecture in a way that's accessible to the general public. And in doing so we try and advertise the lecture widely throughout the host city and also to local schools to try and get school children to come along and get engaged in physiology and really understand what physiology is about and how exciting research can be. So this year we were very honoured when Professor Dame Nancy Rothwell agreed to come and present the lecture this year. Nancy is very well known as one of our most eminent neuroscientists and so is extremely appropriate for this lecture simply on her academic credentials. She's also known, however, as someone who is great for the community of physiology. She's been involved at many different levels. She's been president of the British Neuroscience Association. She's currently president of the Society of Biology. She's recently been appointed vice-chancellor and president of the University of Manchester. She's also a Dame of the British Empire, member of the Royal Society, a Vice President of the Royal Society, chairs its Education Committee. So an amazing contribution to the science as a whole. In addition, she's very well known as a communicator of science in the media, talks about physiology and science in most media, in print media, television, radio, and was well known for giving the Royal Institution Christmas lectures a few years ago, which she did very successfully. So this commitment to the public engagement of science just made her ideal for this particular lecture. She's also managed to write a book on Who Wants to Be a Scientist, which was a successor to Peter Medawar's classic Advice to a Young Scientist. And her book is, I think, set to become a classic in its own right. It provides lots of very good advice on science, how to do science, what it means to be a scientist, and how to really fulfill yourself as a scientist, I think, is the best way of doing that, of describing that. So we're very pleased to have her as an eminent academic, as an eminent communicator of science to the general public, and as someone who has a real skill for engaging with a wide audience. And so I think, given her expertise in neuroscience, very topical area these days with an aging population, the predominance of neurophysiological pathologies, this is an excellent lecture, an excellent lecturer.
Thank you, Clive. First of all, can you hear me on the back row? Put your hands up. Good. Okay. Thank you very much indeed. Well, it's a pleasure and a privilege to be invited to give this lecture in Manchester. Welcome, everybody, to the University of Manchester. I hope you're enjoying yourselves. This is entitled a public lecture, but from the number of red ribbons I can see around people's necks, it looks rather heavily dominated by physiologists. So apologies to you physiologists, because this lecture is directed at those who are not physiologists. And what I'm going to do is tell you a little bit about our research, about the conditions that we study, and about where it's going. So this will be a broad brush approach to what I would call tracking down killers in the brain. And I had to put this up, it's the first time I've used it, but thanks to David Donaldson in Edinburgh, who drew this rather unflattering cartoon of me. Or perhaps it is flattering, I don't know. But one of the interesting things to me about physiology is it really is about how things work and how they don't work in their most complex states. And one of the most complicated things that we know of, probably the most complicated thing in the universe, is the human brain. And of course, it contains hundreds of billions of cells which interconnect to control almost everything we do. Most important of these are the nerve cells or the neurons. And importantly, with a few limited exceptions, when neurons die, they are not replaced. So unlike if you damage your muscle or your skin or your liver, as might be done a little later on, there is some recovery. But with neurons, there's virtually no recovery whatsoever. And hence, minor damage can be fatal. And that's one of the reasons why collectively there's a group of diseases, which I would call brain killer diseases, which account for more deaths and disability than anything else in the world. Now, the diseases you see here look pretty different, actually. Many of them tend to affect older people, like strokes and Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's and so on. But some of them affect quite young people. Brain injury is something that happens commonly in the young, particularly males. Nearly all sporting accidents, motorcycle accidents or fights. And in fact, I heard the remarkable fact that in the United States, the single greatest cause of death in young males is gunshot wounds to the head. But although these diseases occur in different people, epilepsy also quite young, and brain tumours can be in people who are quite young, and they present very differently. Some of them are very sudden onset, like a brain injury or very often a stroke. Others take years or decades before they fully present. They do have a number of important features in common, and that is that neurons are damaged and their neurons are die, and that affects the patient's ability to function and often ends their life. And that's an important common feature of each of these diseases, which I'll come back to at the end. The area we focused on particularly is stroke. So a stroke occurs, of course, when there's reduced blood flow and oxygen to parts of the brain, and it is actually the third greatest killer in the Western world. It's a condition known as cerebral ischemia, the reduced level of blood flow, and it can occur in a number of other conditions. In a stroke, it most commonly occurs when a brain artery blocks, and I'll come back to that in a moment. But cerebral ischemia, or reduced blood flow to the brain and therefore damage, can also happen when a brain artery bleeds, when there's poor general circulation, in heart failure, in drowning, in low oxygen, when there's low oxygen for babies at birth, and sorry, I know there is at least one neurosurgeon here, but dare I say it, during surgery as well, where occasionally the patients suffer from cerebral ischemia. And one of the problems here is that the treatment is incredibly limited. I'll come on to a treatment in a moment. But most of the treatments are managing patients and trying to prevent further strokes, or in patients at risk, trying to stop them from getting a stroke. So this illustrates why it's really good to work in Manchester if you work on stroke. This is the adjusted mortality rates for stroke, and it's really good news if you live somewhere down here in Norfolk, but you'll see Salford, where most of our clinical studies are undertaken, Liverpool, where we collaborate, and here's Manchester. Now, don't worry, by visiting Manchester for this meeting, you're not likely to suddenly get a stroke. I hope. Well, it depends what you do later. But of course, what this reflects is levels of lifestyle. Stroke, like heart attacks, like most of the other major diseases, are associated with poor diet, with smoking, with drinking, with lack of exercise, and so on. So that's no surprise. You're going to say, yeah, I do all of those. And of course, the damage caused by a major stroke can be absolutely devastating. Often, we refer to a stroke now as a brain attack, in the same way as we know about a heart attack. Of course, in a heart attack, an artery supplying the muscle in the heart blocks, and therefore the tissue dies. Exactly the same thing happens in the brain. And it's been calculated, I'm not quite sure how, but that every minute after a major stroke, 2 billion brain cells are lost, 14 billion connections are gone, and 7.5 miles of wiring are destroyed. Clearly, that can't go on for long before the patient ultimately dies. So what we need to understand first is what happens in the brain after a stroke. And this cartoon here illustrates a typical condition. And what very often happens is an artery like this one, often a middle cerebral artery, blocks because of a clot expanded here, that blocks the artery either permanently or temporarily, and therefore the tissue supplied by this artery, its territory if you like, some of it dies immediately and some of it dies later. And a critical finding in stroke in both experimental studies and in clinical studies is that actually some of the tissue doesn't die for quite a long time. So there is this concept of the umbra, where there is very, very low oxygen and the cells don't survive for very long at all, and the penumbra, this much larger area, which may survive for hours. And critical is understanding what converts that small area of damage into the much larger area of damage, because we might be able to salvage that. And of course, if we can't, then the consequences are very dire indeed, as you don't need to be a neuropathologist to see there's something wrong with this brain, I think. But the cause of stroke, of course, is outside the brain, almost always. The cause is atherosclerosis. The fatty deposits you see in blood vessels that accumulate as a result of either genetic factors or poor diet or various other things. And again, this means that a brain attack, a stroke, is very comparable to a heart attack. Actually, they're very often the same groups of patients that suffer both of these conditions. By the way, I should have said at the beginning, if there's anybody here who doesn't like gory, there are just a few gory slides. I'll signal, if you like, gory coming up, and you can, but I'm assuming the physiologist won't mind gory. So we shouldn't forget that although we treat stroke as a neurological disease, because it happens in the brain, its origins are in the blood vessels. It's a vascular disease in almost all of the cases that I mentioned previously. We are now able to unblock the arteries that are blocked during a stroke in some patients. And we can do this with an enzyme called TPA that was developed for treatment of the victims of heart attacks. And the effects of TPA are illustrated very well here. This poor patient apparently came into hospital with all the severe symptoms of a stroke, so they're paralyzed down one side and can't speak well, semi-conscious and so on. And it's very easy to see the reason why there's a blockage in this artery. The patient's given TPA, and then, lo and behold, the blood flows again. And this, when it was discovered, was held as a miracle drug. TPA could literally save people who were semi-paralyzed, who sometimes almost in a coma, if it unblocked the clot quickly enough. But it was quickly realized that TPA had some problems. And one of the problems is that it can also cause bleeding in the brain. So any patient who already has some bleeding can't have TPA. So the first thing that means is you've got to ascertain that the patient hasn't had a bleed in the brain before they get TPA, and that delays treatment. Then the second problem is that if TPA is given too late, then it actually can make the patient worse, mainly through bleeding. So it must be given within the first few hours of when you know that stroke occurred. And that it is increasingly being given in hospitals in Britain, but obviously it relies on patients presenting quickly. And that's fine if somebody's with a patient when they collapse. They can say, yes, an hour ago they collapsed and they were fine. But if they were on their own or it was in their sleep, then it isn't so useful. And the story I often tell is that when TPA was first licensed in the United States, the head of the division at the National Institutes of Health, who led on TPA, decided that what he must do is make people recognize the symptoms of a stroke such that they presented in hospital much more quickly so they could get TPA. And instead of putting out leaflets and TV adverts, as we have done here, he put the case of a patient just like this on the soap opera ER. So the patient rushes in and semi-paralyzed, gives TPA, gets up and walks away. And it was a great way of getting across to the American public that if you have these symptoms, you must go to hospital. The problem is that that episode of ER was shown on British television before TPA was licensed. So it was a slight difficulty here. But this shows a number of important things, actually. The fact that TPA can work, it means that this part of the brain here, although suffering and probably going to die, it can be saved if the blood flow can be restored. But it also means that if it's still alive at this point, perhaps even if we can't fully restore the blood flow, we can do something from stopping those cells from dying if we know exactly why. Because we know that they have enough oxygen to live. They're just teetering right on the brink of life or death. So it's really important to understand what happens in those cells. And we know, in fact, that most cells that die in the brain after a stroke are killed by their neighbours. So what happens is a neuron is damaged, probably because it's got very low oxygen, got no blood at all. It spills out lots of its contents, which are toxic, and that kills the healthy neurons around. Therefore, we need to understand what those toxins are and how we can control them. And then we might be able to stop the secondary death that occurs after the first events in a stroke. Well, actually, we know a great deal about some of these molecules that are produced and spilled out by dying neurons. Lots of them have been discovered. And in fact, many of them are now being taken forwards as possible treatments, although I'll come back to that in a moment. But the question is, how do you find what goes on in the brain of a patient after a stroke? Well, of course, we have some fantastic techniques available to us through imaging, particularly with PET imaging, positron emission tomography, where you can actually see very early changes in the brain of a patient. And you can do functional studies to ask what, not just what the brain looks like, but how much blood is flowing, what's being released, and so on. We can, and as I'll show you at the end, do use surgical patients. Don't worry, this is a volunteer. Don't know where the blood came from, though. But we do use patients where we can get access to the brain, though these are not stroke patients. But what, of course, we can't do is to simply look inside the brain, either of a healthy individual before they have a stroke, or less so, a patient who's already had a stroke. Therefore, almost all of our discoveries on what contributes to the damage after a stroke, on potential treatments for stroke, have been derived from studies on animals, almost exclusively on rodents. And in fact, these animals have the same cells, the same molecules, very similar blood supply, and if they have a stroke or a stroke is induced, the damage emerges in a very similar way to that it does in humans. And in fact, the slide I showed you earlier demonstrated what happened when there's a blockage in the middle cerebral artery of a person. And this is what happens. The damage results here, and this will be quite severe. If we take rats and mice and anaesthetize them and block that middle cerebral artery, the damage looks like this. It's remarkably similar. Actually, though, rodents do better functionally, and of course they don't have the problems of, you don't have to ask them questions like, do you remember your wife's name, or where do you work? But in fact, the damage is remarkably similar. And using these approaches, a number of toxins or killers in the brain have been identified. Some of these, of course, are molecules that are essential for normal brain function. And a particularly interesting one that's been the focus of a huge amount of attention here is this molecule called glutamate. It's an amino acid, so you find it in protein. And by the way, don't ask me the question I was asked once, so if I was a vegetarian, am I less likely to get a stroke? And when I worked it out, the reasoning behind that was because this is in proteins, and therefore if I eat less protein, then it will be better for me. Logical question, actually. And of course, we all have glutamate in our brains, and it's essential for normal function. We all have calcium. Hopefully, we don't have too many free radicals. And I'll come on to the immune molecules in a moment. And of course, what happens to glutamate is that under normal physiological conditions, it's very, very tightly regulated. It's released in little tiny packets, in little blips, as signals, as electrical signals are sent down nerves. And then it's quickly sucked back up again into cells when it's not needed anymore. So it doesn't hang around, because glutamate is bad news if you have too much of it. But what happens after a stroke is there is an explosive increase. So this is released from cells that are damaged or dying, are going to die, and these levels of glutamate, even here, will kill the cells around them. It's a frightening thought that we've got enough glutamate to kill our own brains several times over. So there were huge efforts put in to trying to develop drugs to block glutamate, stop it being released, or to stop it from acting, to block its effects on cells. And all so far have failed. Now here there's a long argument between the scientists who say the clinicians did the trials wrong and the clinicians who say the scientists gave us the wrong approaches to use. Both are partly true. But it's particularly challenging, I think, to block processes like these because of this. Because we need glutamate, like we need calcium and we need sodium, for our brains to function normally. Trying to leave this normal release intact while block this explosive release is a huge challenge, and actually so far has not proven successful. So we've sort of taken a different approach, and we've said, well, are the processes in the brain that happen after a stroke that are not involved in normal brain function? They're not part of what we call normal physiology. There are features specifically of disease like stroke. And of course, the classical hallmark of many diseases is inflammation, shown here in rheumatoid arthritis. Now, for many years, people didn't look particularly at inflammation in the brain, apart from in a few conditions like multiple sclerosis. But people who worked on inflammation weren't interested in brains, and people who worked on brains weren't interested in inflammation. But actually, now we know, and this is growing, this field is exploding, that inflammation is popping up all over the place in many of the major diseases that we're aware of. So it's been known about for a long time in arthritis and asthma and inflammatory bowel disease, but it's very important in cancer. Now in diabetes, psoriasis obviously, but also in obesity, a risk factor for stroke, and in atherosclerosis, a primary cause, and now in brain diseases. So the key question we started to address quite a long time ago was, could inflammation contribute to the damage after a stroke? And if it was a disease process and therefore not needed for normal function, maybe we can just block it and there won't be any side effects. Well, we know that the brain is different to other organs in its inflammatory response. For a start, it doesn't swell, or we hope it doesn't swell too much when it gets the disease, because the skull's around it. There are slightly different molecules, and the white blood cells from the blood don't go into the brain as quickly as other tissues. But nevertheless, we also know it does have inflammatory cells, and it does have inflammatory molecules. And some of the molecules that you find in that inflamed joints in that lady's hand, or in that atherosclerotic lesion, or in that psoriasis in the skin, are the same molecules you can see in the brain after a stroke and in other diseases. And we know, actually, that it isn't particularly the neurons that produce these inflammatory molecules, because there are many other cell types involved in the events after a stroke. Everybody tends to focus on the neurons, hence it's called the central nervous system. Actually, it should really be called the central glial system, because there are more of them. And then in disease, you get these blood cells coming in that can do all sorts of damage to neurons. So there are lots of different cell types. And particularly important seem to be these cells, the glia, of which there are many different types. Now, glia were thought for a long time to be just scaffolding. Glia means glue. They hold the neurons together, therefore nobody's interested in them. Actually, people are now very interested in glia because we know they have a lot of functions. They aren't just glue. So they make up a large part of the brain, but they're involved in support, nutrition, communication, repair. They're essential for brain function, but they can both help by releasing protective factors and cause brain damage by releasing toxins. So we know that glia can kill neurons. So the damaged neuron might not just kill its neighbour, but it can activate glia that releases toxins that also kills neurons. And some of the molecules released by the glia are the same molecules released by our immune cells. These are inflammatory molecules. There are many of these, but the particular ones that we've looked at are a group of molecules called cytokines. There are hundreds of these. I can't keep up with them. They're normally produced by immune cells, but there are virtually no detectable levels of cytokines in healthy tissue, which is good because it means that they're not involved in normal physiology. But they're released by glia in damaged brain. And we focused on this one. Called interleukin-1. It was originally called the endogenous pyrogen because it was the molecule that everybody thought caused fever. And interleukin-1 is the reason you feel so bloody awful when you have flu. It's interleukin-1 that gives you a fever, that makes you feel achy, that makes you feel sleepy, that makes you not want to eat. I should just comment on how it was discovered. It wasn't divine intervention, in fact, but it was a group of scientists who realized that if they were trying to get the molecule that caused fever, they would need to try to get a lot of people with a fever. And what they did was isolated the first interleukin-1 from about 200 liters of urine from nuns in a convent who all got flu at the same time. So there's an interesting approach to research for future. And we know that in the brain of an animal, and we know a bit about people, there's hardly any IL-1 normally, but it increases explosively after the stroke. Now, the same as the glutamate, but IL-1 isn't essential for all the functions that glutamate's essential for. What it's important for is combating infection, because, of course, inflammation is a good thing for our bodies. It's our natural defense. But the problem is that all too often, inflammation increases by too much or for too long or in the wrong place or at the wrong time. And so many diseases, as I showed you, are diseases where our own body defenses are inappropriate. And so this appears to be an inappropriate response. The IL-1 is mostly found in the glia. These are microglia, the little glia. And here, the green here are the microglia and the cells around. That's a blood vessel, that round thing there in the brain. And here's where the IL-1 is produced after a stroke. So it's produced mainly around here. So the big question we had quite a long time ago was, okay, so IL-1's produced in the brain after a stroke. Is it helping cells to recover? Is it doing nothing? It's just an innocent bystander. Or is it actually contributing to the damage? Now, in physiology, the classical way you answer those questions is you say you take normal animals or cells, and then you take ones where the levels of the IL-1 are higher, and then you take cells or animals where the levels of the IL-1 are lower or its effects have been blocked. Now, normally, you rely, therefore, on specific drugs and tools to block the effects of the compound you're looking at, like IL-1. We, in fact, were very fortunate because there is a naturally occurring blocker of IL-1, and it's called a receptor antagonist, and many drugs are based on receptor antagonist. And the way it works is a bit like a lock and a key, because molecules like IL-1 all act on cells by docking into a very specific receptor site. Nothing else docks into that site and makes that cell be turned on apart from IL-1. It's that specific. But the naturally occurring blocker, or the antagonist as it's called, fits into the site but doesn't trigger the cell to activate. So it's a bit like the key being stuck on the inside of the door, and so you can't actually open the door. So this competitive antagonist, which is incredibly safe and it's actually used in patients, can be used to ask that question. What happens if we increase IL-1 levels? What happens to brain damage? And what happens if we block its effects with this antagonist? And this we can do in cells and in animals which have had a stroke. So if we look at the damage caused by a stroke, and there are lots of ways we can do that, and in the group here it's about there, if we increase IL-1, and we can do this either by injecting IL-1, or it can happen naturally in animals or people with inflammation or infection. And important to remember that infection is a big risk factor for stroke, and actually it makes a lot of people worse if they get an infection after stroke. The damage is massively increased. If we give the IL-1 blocker, the damage is dramatically reduced. So this suggests, and a lot of other experiments using a lot of different approaches, that the IL-1 released in the brain by the glia after a stroke contributes to the damage. And if we have more IL-1, for example, if we have an infection at the time, the damage might be worse because of the IL-1. If we have a lot of IL-1 RA, and this is naturally occurring, so we do have IL-1 RA, we might suffer less damage. And if we could give IL-1 RA, we might then be able to reduce the damage. And we might have a blockbuster drug, which we'll come back to in a moment. But first, I just want to deviate for a moment to ask the question, how do cells die? Because, okay, these cells die in the brain after a stroke, but how do they die, and does it matter how they die, actually? Well, it probably does matter. And here I want to deviate slightly to tell you a brief story about a worm, and I'll tell you why in a moment. Some of you will know, of course. And actually, cells can die in two ways. They can be murdered by neighbouring cells or by huge challenges which bust them open, or they can commit suicide. And the murder is a process called necrosis, where the cells swell and release all their contents. It's a very nasty way to die. They make a horrible mess. They take everybody else out with them when they're going. Whereas suicide is a process called apoptosis. And it's a program of events that the cell gets a message to say, time to die now. Sorry, Grim Reaper's here. And the cell very neatly collapses itself in. This is very important because when we get an infection, we make lots more immune cells in our blood. And when the infection's gone, they've got to go away again. Well, if they all spilled out their contents and made a mess, that would be pretty devastating. They don't. They shrink down. And this process is really important because failure of this suicide in cells that are damaged is the cause of cancer. Overactivation of this process has now been implicated in many diseases. Now, obviously, it's important to try to find out what the mechanisms are that drive a cell to survive or die when they get a death signal. And we know that a death signal to many cells can either activate protective factors, so the cell survives, or it can activate the death pathway, and so the cell dies neatly and quietly and it's gone away. But what are those signals? Well, as many of you here will know, the signals were worked out not in brain cells, not in human cells, but actually in worm cells, in a famous worm known as C. elegans. And the reason scientists were studying this worm was because it seemed really odd that they're born with more cells than they need in their nervous system, and they always seem to end up with about the same number. Now, that couldn't be chance. So the scientists worked out that this had to be a program. There had to be signals telling some of those cells, you die, you live. And so they looked for the genes which told cells to die and told them to live. And the one they found that told the worm cells to die was called SED3, C. elegans death 3. Obviously not much success with one or two. But this gene here makes a protein that tells a worm cell to die. Very exciting. If you're a worm physiologist. But of course, what they then did was said, well, is there anything like SED3 in humans or mammals? I mean, now we've got the whole human genome, but they hadn't at the time. And they looked, not expecting to find anything. But there in the human genome was a gene that was very like SED3. And that gene was called ICE, interleukin-1 converting enzyme. Now, I'll come back to that in a second, but I tell you this story for two reasons. Firstly, it led to the scientist for the Nobel Prize, and so we can do some publicity because John Sulston's now in Manchester. But secondly, because I think it conveys a really important message that we are just not good at getting across. Who would have predicted that studies on the development of a worm could have produced the biggest breakthroughs in understanding cancer, cell death, degenerative diseases? It was great science, it was great questions, but nobody would have predicted that fundamental science would have had such great implications. So it's a good story to tell when people say, well, it's fine if we support applied science but not fundamental science. And the other answer, I think, is from a colleague of mine who when he's told, well, it's fine, we'll support applied science but not the fundamental discovery, he always says that's a bit like saying I'll buy a lottery ticket but only if it's the one that's going to win, because you couldn't have predicted the worm. But back to the interleukin-1 converting enzyme. It's now called caspase-1. This is the mammal's equivalent of the worm enzyme. And what we know, and what we knew then actually, is that this cuts what's called proIL-1, which is not active, to make it into active IL-1. So this enzyme that was discovered completely independently of our work actually releases the active form of the molecule that we're working on in brain disease. And in fact, it provides another target to try and stop the IL-1 being active, because we can get inhibitors of this enzyme which block the release of active IL-1, and what we find is they also reduce the damage caused by a stroke. So this is another way of blocking IL-1, not by stopping it from acting on cells, but by stopping it from ever getting out of cells in its active form. And indeed, there are lots of other ways in which we now know we can block IL-1. But we know that brain inflammation is complicated and involves a lot of different cells, and the IL-1 seems to act on many of them. Interestingly, it doesn't kill neurons directly. Now, if you remember what I told you a bit ago, you should feel reassured now, because if anybody's got the symptoms of flu, you'll have IL-1 in your hypothalamus. But don't worry, it's not killing neurons. It seems to only kill brain cells when they're already susceptible and when they're threatened. And in fact, it seems to be made mainly by these small glial cells, and it seems to work mainly by releasing toxins from other cells, these other glial cells here, and it also helps blood cells, immune cells, to get into the brain, and they also wreak havoc as well. So it does a lot of different things. And in fact, the control of IL-1 is incredibly complicated, and a very simplified version that we actually looked at in a scientific meeting today is shown here. This is an oversimplification, and this is just to say that one of the approaches that we're taking is working with colleagues who are systems biologists and computational biologists, is using systems approaches to look at multiple interventions in these complex pathways to try and find out just which bit of this tube map is the important stop where we could change IL-1. And interestingly, of course, you'll all have heard Dennis Noble's comment that systems biology, which is very fashionable, is physiology with funding. So if you're a physiologist, get into systems biology as quick as you can, because it's a good way of doing it and of working with colleagues. This is all very well, but what does it mean for the patients? Well, we know that infection and inflammation are a risk for stroke, and we also, and particularly so in patients who already have other risk factors. So there was a great study done a few years ago by Patrick Vallance, who showed that in older people who had some risk factors, if they had an upper respiratory tract infection, they had about 5 times the chances of getting either a stroke or a heart attack in the next few weeks. So we know that the infection and inflammation, which increase IL-1, will increase your chances of getting a stroke. We also know that patients who have an infection just after their stroke, and that's not uncommon, or indeed just after other conditions, do worse. A critical question is whether in patients cytokines do worsen outcome, and of course the big question is, could blocking IL-1 be used as a possible treatment? Well, we've taken a number of approaches to this. One of many of these involve stroke patients, some other patients, but some of them using PET imaging, which I showed you at the beginning, because you can actually use PET imaging to look at the microglia that are activated, the cells that are producing the IL-1. So this patient's had a stroke. This is courtesy of a colleague, Richard Bernardi, here, and we've he's injected into this patient a very low dose of radioactive molecule which binds to the microglia. And so this shows you where the R1 is being produced, and it's right around where the damage is. We've also looked at whether or not these glia are activated in the patients who we think are at risk of a stroke. And on the top are four patients who have a lot of risk factors for stroke, haven't had one yet, and four on the bottom, the RAGE match, that have no risk factors for stroke. So this preliminary study suggests that patients with risk factors for stroke already have increased brain inflammation. And we found the same thing in animals. If they have risk factors for stroke, their brain is already switched on and primed. And that may be one of the triggers for a stroke. But obviously, the important question is IL-1RA a possible therapy? Well, in order to answer that question, we have to ask, does it get into the brain? Actually, does it have to get into the brain? But the first question was, does it get into the brain? Is it safe? And does it work? Well, it's very difficult to measure how well molecules get into the brain in people. You can do it in animals, and that's fine, but people are different, and obviously the strokes are slightly different. So it's very difficult to answer that question. So what we've done is we've used another approach to try and answer that question. And that's working with a group of patients, Gori coming up, by the way, a group of patients, not who've had a stroke, but who've had a subarachnoid hemorrhage. So they've had a bleeding, normally caused by an aneurysm here, well, this little blip, and actually the damage they get in their brain is very similar, or for some of them, to a stroke. So a lot of these patients actually get a second stroke afterwards. But the reason we use these patients isn't just because they get a second stroke, and they're also valuable because they have that while they're in hospital. So they come into a hospital because they've had a hemorrhage, and then they usually get the stroke a few days later. But the reason is a technical one, because a lot of these patients have raised pressure inside the brain. So they have to have what's called a drain put in. So it's inserted, sorry, more gory here. This is clipping off the aneurysm, to drain off the fluid around the brain, the cerebrospinal fluid, in order to reduce the pressure. So we can use these patients to administer IL-1RA and take off the cerebrospinal fluid and ask, does the IL-1RA get into the brain in what we think are sufficient quantities? And actually, we feel it does. So this graph shows the results of a group of patients who've been infused with the IL-1 blocker, and then we've measured its levels in blood. It goes up very fast, very high, and these are the levels in the cerebrospinal fluid around the brain, and we know that this level would, at least in animals, be enough to protect them. So this suggests that probably enough does get in. Now, actually, we don't know that it has to get in, because if I told you, a stroke is caused by vascular disease, and actually a lot of the inflammation is probably happening in the blood vessels outside the brain. So it might help if it both acts there and inside the brain. So taking it into patients, actually IL-1RA is incredibly safe, and it's been used in patients to treat rheumatoid arthritis. So we carried out a study which is called a phase 2 study, and what that means is phase 1 is when you try something in normal human beings, and phase 2 is when you try it in patients. The studies aren't big enough to tell you if it's going to work or not, but they tell you if it's feasible to give it, or if the patients don't like it, tries to get the doses right, and so on. And we carried out this study a few years ago, so it was a small study, and double-blinded, placebo-controlled and randomised. Basically, that means we didn't know what we were giving them, but somebody did, fortunately. So it was given blind against a non-effective treatment. And we mainly want to look at how safe it was. And it was very safe. We had no problems at all whatsoever with the patients, and no cause for concerns. We looked at the levels of some inflammatory markers in the blood of these patients, because we thought that might give us an indication of whether the IL-1 block was working. And we looked at various different molecules. These are white cells. This is a particular sort of white cell, the neutrophil, and these are markers of inflammation. On every graph, the upper line is the stroke patients who got the placebo. So the first thing you can see is they go up pretty quickly after a stroke because they're getting an inflammatory response. The second thing is the IL-1RA knocked them down. Now, that's a good sign because each of these biomarkers correlates with how badly the patient's going to do. The higher the IL-6, the worse they're likely to fare. So just by knocking this down, let alone any other effect, then there is a suggestion the patients might do better. It was a very small study, but we did look at how they were doing at 3 months old. 3 months later, these are neurological scores, which I don't pretend to understand. But the simplest way I explain it is that white scored and black's dead. So on both of them, this is the placebo, and this is the placebo. This is the R1 blocker, and this is the R1 blocker. So it looked pretty promising in that there were more patients doing well with the R1 blocker and less patients dying. But obviously, this is something we need to take forward into a larger trial, which we're hoping the MRC will fund soon. We do need to do some further studies, but the larger trial is fundable potentially by the government or other sources, but a really big trial would require millions of pounds. Now, here's an interesting thing which I didn't expect as a physiologist to have to do, which is the complicated situation that an American biotech company holds the original patent to make this R1 blocker. They've licensed it to a Swedish biotech company, but not for treatment in stroke. The University of Manchester holds the use patent for this agent in stroke. So, hey, who knows what's going to happen? We shall see. Obviously, if it works, everybody will be interested in it. If it doesn't, nobody will. But just briefly, in the last few minutes, to say that, I mean, I've focused largely on stroke, but we now know that the levels of IL-1 is increased in the brain in all of those conditions I showed you at the beginning, in Alzheimer's, in Parkinson's, and in epilepsy, and so on. And there's growing evidence that it contributes to these diseases as well. There's very good evidence, experimental evidence, that IL-1 contributes to seizures. The evidence is less good, more circumstantial for Alzheimer's, because we don't have quite such good animal models, but certainly there is growing evidence that it might be important. And in fact, if you look at Alzheimer's, the main risk factors, well, genetics is one, although it's rare. These are the two twins that Alzheimer found. The most common risk factor, of course, is age. But a third risk factor for getting Alzheimer's is a head injury. And that's been reported for a long time. Next slide, gory, but from a film, so don't worry. And in fact, a group that is very susceptible to Alzheimer's and other forms of dementia is boxers that get this dementia pugilistica, as it's called. And there was a study done of people, not just boxers, who died quite early after a head injury. And they already were starting to show the signs of Alzheimer's in the brain. And in fact, they had high IL-1 levels as well. And the other evidence that inflammation might be important, although it's still very controversial, is the fact that apart from that we get increased inflammation in the brain of people with Alzheimer's, anti-inflammatory drugs have been associated with a reduced risk, although this is still controversial at the present time. So where we are now, we're trying to understand exactly what switches on IL-1. Could we stop that? Exactly how does it work, and which is the best way to stop it working? But clinically, probably our best bet at the moment is IL-1RA, the IL-1 blocker, because it's so safe, it's been in humans, and we're at the point now of going to larger trials to determine if it works. And hopefully then we'll be very, very rich indeed, but I suspect that's incredibly unlikely. So an important part of research, of course, is the teams that do it, and these are only part of them, but apologies for this slide. This is the key members of the clinical team recruiting a patient here. Particularly could I highlight, led by Pippa Tyrrell, who's Director of Stroke Studies at HOPE, and Andy King, who's the lead consultant for neurosurgery, who does this work, and the others, the extremely important research registrars and research nurses. And the people in the lab here in Manchester, I think this is almost current. We changed it slightly because previously they were all in the bar, but I think we only have a few of them now in the bar. This is unfortunate. I just see a picture of me dancing here. But it's interesting that Clive commented on Peter Medawar at the beginning, because he's a great hero of mine, and I really like this statement, which is, you don't need to be terrifically brainy to be a good scientist, and most people who are in fact scientists could easily have done something else instead. Well, that's fortunate, because I'm hoping for the foreseeable future I'm going to be both a scientist and a vice-chancellor, so we'll see how I do at both. Thank you all for listening.